So, are we calling someone up?
Yeah, so I'm really excited. Guys, this is always one of my, I'm gonna say it again, it's one of my favorite lectures. I say it all the time. Guys, you know, when we tonight talked about the Santa Cruz Challenge, we really want to remind everyone that a lot of people sign up for the Santa Cruz Challenge because they want to feel good in their bodies. That's just, it's such a driving force. It's like, and when we interview people at the very beginning, it's always, I sign up because I want to tone up, or I want to lose weight, or I want to get more involved. And there's something about the physical aspect of the Santa Cruz Challenge that is a huge driving force. And there's still two other major components, and that's our relationships to everything that we do and the relationship to the environment. And we believe strongly in how we relate to the environment and our planet because we believe that it's tied to our legacy. You know, so once we set foot off this planet, or whatever, you know, this dimension, there's something that we want to leave behind for all the other generations, and we're doing that every day. It's a daily practice, you know, how we're going to relate to our environment and everything that we leave behind. So I think it's really important that we leave things a little bit better than when we showed up. And I think we're kind of going in the opposite direction right now. There's just this huge force of so much consumption and waste, and it's so unnecessary. And so I'm really happy that we have Jackie Nunez, did I say that right, Nunez here today, of The Last Plastic Straw. And it's kind of a funny story. Tanya, our program director, was in Puerto Rico. And she was hanging on the beach with her family, and she saw a gal coming by, and she was picking out straws. And they got to talking, and they're like, you know, they just started chit-chatting, and it turned out that they realized, oh my gosh, we're on vacation, and we're both from Santa Cruz. And that's how they kind of started talking about, you know, what they do. So it was a pretty interesting story, and Tanya told us about Jackie. And a couple of things I know about Jackie is that she's very passionate about the environment, very passionate about water and water sports, and very passionate about community, very community-driven and volunteer work. And that's how she came to create The Last Plastic Straw, which is also, I believe, a volunteer community center with Save Our Shores. And we've hosted Save Our Shores pretty much every year, so we're really happy to bring Jackie here with The Last Plastic Straw as another portion of just that commitment to the community. So, Jackie Nunez, please come on up.
Well, thank you. Yeah, that was a great intro. We met on the beach, which was really great. I've been fortunate enough to be able to go back to Puerto Rico. I have extended family there. And so I was actually picking up straws for this campaign. I was seeing straws everywhere. But I'd have to say, though, I'm the least likely person to be talking to you about this, or I would never have thought that I would start anything like this. You go ahead and do the slide. Because I'm a self-described slacktivist. up until a few years ago, I would just, you know, get online, sign petitions, post things on Facebook, like, yeah, you know, and share that kind of stuff with my friends, but really not take any real action. I'm a traveler. I like to travel a lot. I've got the bug, and my family's moved around a lot, so I just kind of like to keep moving. And really, what happens is you don't really get invested in your community when that happens. And I've had a lot of seasonal jobs. I've done river guiding. I've worked in the resort industry, working for Club Med and traveling all around. I've done a lot of different things and just kept myself moving. So Santa Cruz actually has been the place that I've been the longest in one spot. And I really feel connected to the Bay and to Santa Cruz as a whole. And first of all, before I go on, I just want to say that it's always good to start off, because when you start talking about plastic pollution, people get pretty bummed out and they feel overwhelmed. And you're going to see some like sad slides, but it's always good to start off with a little bit of love, and just knowing that you love your community and love where you live, and just coming from that space and that place of just really wanting to protect what you love. So yeah, I'm a kayak guide. I do that here in the Monterey Bay, and I sometimes get to travel. Next one. I also get to do a few trips in British Virgin Islands as crew, and that's a lot of fun. And then I also like to hike, and I also do outrigger canoeing. That's the next one. So And I'm fortunate enough to call Santa Cruz home and to be able to do these kind of sports. Like I said, one of the things that's been great is I did live in Puerto Rico when I was in junior high school as well. So, and then recently, got an extended family there. So for the last 30 years, I've had this unique perspective where I've been going back to the same beaches, and I could see the impact. And it's pretty staggering, the amount of plastic pollution you see anywhere. So I've been able to see firsthand what's been going on in Puerto Rico as an island, but also in Santa Cruz with the beach cleanups and stuff to save our shores. We still, in perfect little Santa Cruz where we recycle and everything, we're still seeing a lot of debris come up on the beaches or be left. I'm going to stay on that slide right now. I'm going to take a moment to ask, how many of you guys have seen plastic pollution in the ocean? Just raise your hands if you've been out. Okay, hold it there. How many of you have seen it on the shoreline on the beaches? Okay, keep your hands up. And waterways, creeks, yep. And then what about just going for hikes in the woods, in the mountains, on trails? Exactly, so just, and then of course sidewalks, gutters, and surround, okay. So you see, it's not going away, and there's no such thing as a way, and especially with plastic. In plastic, and disposable and plastic should never be used in a sentence, I feel. Because there's no such thing as disposable plastic, it doesn't dispose. There is no way. So, go ahead. So if you guys have traveled at all in the last 10 years, you've seen that the problem's gotten worse. And it's just getting worse exponentially. This is a common scene. They're actually talking about designating plastic as a toxic substance. I used to call it toxic waste, but I got corrected by biologists who've been studying this, and if they can designate a toxic substance, there's an area in Hawaii that can be claimed a Superfund site. And so they're going on that status so that we can start cleaning up and get some producer responsibility. So just so you guys know, there is work being done on the end as far as the waste byproduct and how we deal with that, and onus on that. Next one. So like you said, it's daunting. 80% of all marine debris found in the ocean is land-based. And 80 to 90% of that is plastic pollution. It's not going away. Go to the next one. So a big part of that problem is a lot of that plastic is single-use disposable plastic. And it's not disposable. Go to the next one. So yes, the problem of plastic. It doesn't biodegrade. It just photodegrades into smaller and smaller pieces. And what happens is it gets ingested by animals, which in turn we ingest those animals. So it ends up getting bioaccumulated. The other bad thing about plastic, the chemical makeup of it actually serves as a sponge for all of the bad chemicals in the air that come down from like global warming and everything, and the CO2s, the dioxins in the air. It gets absorbed by the plastic, which normally the ocean would dissipate it. But if there's a little piece of plastic floating in that ocean, that's gonna attach to that. So now that toxic piece of plastic is 10 times more toxic. And then the fish are gonna eat it, and the bigger fish are gonna eat it, and then we're gonna eat the fish. So that is the problem. So another thing about it too, people say, well, what about recycling? Well, only a small percentage of plastic gets recycled. Very small, and it's only once. So still in our environment. So if you think of it this way, every piece of plastic that's ever been made is still in our environment. Even if you burn it, if the dioxins is in the air, they settle on the plants, we eat the plants, the animals eat the plants, we eat the animals. So we all have actually, it gets bioaccumulated in us, and it's found in the mother's breast milk. We store it in our fat. So the problem is too, is I feel that the big source of the plastic pollution problem is, you know, being from the U.S., I feel really bad when I travel and I see all this and how much of our products are being pushed down there with the shipping and industrial food systems. And so when you see a statistic like that, then you really realize our impacts on this problem. That picture up there on the far left, that's actually from Life magazine. They introduced plastics as throwaway living, how the wives don't have to do dishes anymore, and it really kind of, you know, snowballed that effect. So anyway, so what I did is I started educating myself I was doing all this traveling, it was really bumming me out, and so I volunteered for Save Our Shores. That's me with the bags. That's 500 bags, and that's what one shopper does in a year. They did until we got the bag ban, right? And so we started bringing our own bags. So that's me at the farmer's market. And I also was fortunate enough, a friend of mine who I knew in Puerto Rico, I went to school with, produced and directed the movie Bag It, which I highly recommend. It's a great movie. It's not a Debbie Downer. There's a lot of great information about plastic pollution. They talk about the history and politics of plastic, to plastics in our environments, to plastics in our bodies, and the whole health aspect. It's really, really good. And it's done with humor and a lot of information. It's really well done. It's one of the best movies I've seen that can affect change on a personal level. And it can span the spectrum. You're not preaching to the choir. And when we showed that in Santa Cruz, it was great because people were walking out with huge smiles on their face. Kids were saying to their parents, that's it, no more plastic bags. Mm-hmm. And I think it really is helping a lot of plastic bag movements when they see this movie. I think you can get it on Netflix anyway. So then I also learned about the Monterey Bay Marine Sanctuary, and that the scientists call it it's so rich in biodiversity that they call it the Serengeti of the Sea. And so it's a real precious part of our ecosystem and part of our ocean, and we have it right here at our doorstep. So it really kills me to see us as residents here, using single-use items and throwing it away and seeing it on our beaches and seeing it time and time again, or our businesses offering it to people visiting our beaches. So it's a big push for me to try to get a lot of the single-use items off the shelves and try to educate people. So I also have, I threw this slide in here too. This is, I don't know if you guys have heard about the Great Pacific Garbage Patch. That's the one that's the most researched. I actually met Charles Moore last month at a symposium, and that's the North Pacific Gyre. And they go back and forth saying it's like twice the size of Texas and all that stuff, but it's basically the size of the United States. And it's growing, it's expanding out. But basically, it's all the rotating ocean currents, and that's where all the plastic and the marine debris like ends up. So there's actually five of them. And then a lot of these other areas, when you get into the Great Lakes or some of these like the Indian Ocean and things like that, you'll see a lot of them there too. A lot of plastic, a lot of stuff being left there. So as a resident of Santa Cruz and an inhabitant of this planet, I really felt. Taking my sanctuary stewardry training seriously, and I really feel a need to protect our bay. So, but I didn't know what to do, and go to the next one. So then I had my last plastic straw moment. I had come back from the Caribbean, and I had seen so much plastic. I got here, I'm doing beach cleanups, but one of the things I realized is that, it's got to start, all the talk about beach cleanup and the ocean cleanup and recycling, that's great. We need to do all that, but we need to stop it at the source. We need to stop it now, because it's just growing and growing and growing. Charles Moore went back to his Pacific garbage patch. He said that it's 100 times worse than he thought it would be at this point when they got more samples, and he was seeing it spreading out further. So what's happening is it's breaking down into smaller pieces. In some areas, the ratio of plastic to plankton is 40-1. So that's what a lot of the animals are eating. So it started I was in Santa Cruz, of all places. I was at a beachside bar. I ordered a glass of water, and it came like this with a straw in it. Mm-hmm. Probably with a lot of ice in it, too. But and that was it. I was like, that was my last straw. That was my last plastic straw moment. And I looked down, and I saw the Water's Precious campaign table tent. I'm like, that's it. It's just simple. Upon request, that they can at least do that, that would just stop a lot of this flow right off the bat. And so in 2011, I started the last plastic straw campaign. And you ask why? Well, I found out that there's 500 million plastic straws used a day, and that's a conservative estimate for the United States. That was a statistic from 2012. And straw manufacturers have put out, and we're not even talking about juice boxes and a lot of fast food industry, but for us, this is the one that we're using. And if you're Curious, it's a big number, but if you need to wrap your head around what that looks like, it's enough to go around the circumference of the world 2.5 times. Well, that's one day's use. Mm-hmm. Enough to, next slide, fill Yankee Stadium over 9 times in a year. Almost 10, but I can't say 10 because it didn't quite make 10 in a year, but it's over 9 times. So, yeah, so the other thing is I found out too is that, next slide, plastic straws, it's not a huge thing. As you see, we get a lot of cigarette butts here, and we get a lot of other items, but it always makes the top 10 of the international coastal cleanup. And in 2014, it went up, it was in 2013, it was number 7, and now it's up to number 5. So it's not going away. And so I just thought, well, this is a really simple, tangible thing that we can do to get people thinking about their single-use plastic use. Locally, we average about 5,000 pieces of plastic or straws. And a lot of it, too, is a lot of the juice boxes and the wrappers on the juice boxes and all that. So we get a lot of that there. And one thing I want you guys to think about it, the average life of a straw in your drink is maybe 5-10 minutes. Some people, even seconds. They didn't ask for it, they take it out. But that's going to stay in our environment forever. You know, and then is that the legacy you want to leave? I mean, think about that. It's going to outlive you in generations to come for that convenience or not. You know, you didn't ask for it. So what I'm asking an individual to do is start asking for no straw to get that dialogue going, and it's huge. I've been talking about this since 2011. This year it's really starting to take off, and I think it's because a lot of people are starting to just ask for no straw when you go to bars and restaurants, and it's starting to just take off. People are contacting me from all over the world. I have a website up now, and so I'm getting emails from London, from Bali, from the Caribbean, and people want to take it on. And that was always my goal with this, movement, is a call to movement. I wanted to have all the information there on my website so that anyone could take it on in their community, in their town, and to just empower themselves about plastic pollution problem and take this on. So yeah, so this is another, this is actually Two Oceans Aquarium in South Africa came up with this graphic, which I really like, but it also coincides with our, with global warming and having to bring down our carbon footprint. And even when Jerry Brown did his acceptance speech and talked about bringing all our levels down and everything, I mean, plastic, single-use plastic is huge and is very carbon intensive at every stage of its existence. And it's really, it really impacts our communities too, having to deal with it on the waste end as well. Next one. So yeah, so that's actually, that's Puerto Rico, this one here. This one's in the Virgin Islands. And this is just walking down the beach and not even that far, and I get this many straws. It's actually quite powerful when I'm walking down the beach and I have this bouquet. I find plastic cups too, so I put them in there and I have these two bouquets of straws, and then I end up, really trying to get them all in there because I just can't fill them up fast enough. So especially a lot of these resort towns, it's terrible. That's what they serve you. And as a traveler, I want to be more conscious about where I'm going. I know it's a huge impact on these islands, and I don't want to add to that. So I'll bring my own reusable stainless steel cup. So when I go to these beachside bars and I order a drink, I have my own cup because they're serving a lot of this stuff in plastic and then asking for no straw. So since I started this, I researched a lot of it, and I'm not alone. There's a lot of campaigns all around the Straw Wars in London. It's a lot of Soho restaurants that just took it on upon themselves, straws upon request. This kid, Milo, he started when he was 9. I think he's 12 now. He's from Vermont, and he travels around and talks to school kids about straws and be straw-free. Environmental Working Group, Down to Last Straw, Two Oceans Aquarium, Plastic Pollution Coalition. So there's a lot more, and even this year alone, there's a group, Straws Upon Request, a woman in Marin, who's done a lot of beach cleanups, and she got junior high school girls to get together and start approaching all the restaurants, and they've got 16 restaurants to switch over to at least do Straws Upon Request. And I want to tell you, the feedback I'm getting from restaurants, they don't believe me, but when I'm like, just try it. And when they try it, they're astonished because 80 to 90% of the people do not want a straw if you don't put it in their drink. So that's a big savings anyways. It's a win-win. So this is the part of the education improvement, but really it's, I want to hit it on all fronts. I also talked to the city of Santa Cruz. The nice thing about being, it's a nonprofit, and the one thing I learned when I was trying to promote Bag-It is I was really just blown away because I've just volunteered for things but never worked at a nonprofit. If any of you guys have or you know much about nonprofits, they compete against each other for the same money and the same goals. And with the bag ban, there were a lot of people working towards the same goal, but I realized they weren't working together. Even when we showed the movie, and they weren't even promoting it, I mean, to other organizations, like, you know, Surf Rider wasn't doing, you know, we were trying to get this alliance, so Save Our Shores actually reached out to Central Coast Sanctuary Alliance, and they reached out to a lot of other nonprofits, especially around the bag ban, to really try to join forces to get the word out, and I think it was very effective. But the nice thing about me, right now it's a volunteer project for Save Our Shores. There's no funding, it's pretty much me and volunteers. So I had a great group of talented people help me with my website. I've had people on my birthday party. I just had a donation jar there, and I was able to raise enough money to go to Georgia for the Plastic Jar Symposium this past March. And it's slowly building, but if anyone wanted to donate to the Last Plastic Straw, you would donate to Save Our Shores. They would get a percentage, and then I would get a percentage too for the campaign. What I feel right now in being not in this area of nonprofit is I'm able to work with a lot of nonprofits. When I speak to them, they go, well, wait a minute, wait, how are you affiliated? I'm like, well, I'm not. You know, they're my umbrella organization. Yes, it's a volunteer project for them. But it actually opens up a lot of doors. I'm able to collaborate with a lot of people. City of Santa Cruz has been great. They have it as part of their green business certification. For 2014, I was able to get that on there. So if a restaurant wanted to be green business certified, they'd have to write straws available upon request. And then we've given them a buffer of time to change over to biodegradable straws. Just so you know, for the city of Santa Cruz, we don't have composting. So the most efficient and best straw, if you're gonna use it once and throw it away, would be a paper straw. And I have a lot of samples there if you guys want to check them out on the table. But they're a lot better than what we had as kids. And they really hold up for the life of the drink. But they truly biodegrade in 30 days. The true definition of a biodegradable straw. So it's been great. I've been working with a lot of different things. NOAA's got the Ocean Guardian program where they work with schools. And so the kids can take this on as a project and have the last plastic straw and have restaurants not give it to them automatically. And for kids, it's great. You know, because they get served straws a lot. So it really empowers them to take a stance. So yeah, the next one.
Oops. Oh, I have the last.
All right. Okay, so basically, the great thing about the straw, what I'm finding, is that it's a tangible way for you. If you're feeling overwhelmed about this plastic pollution problem, this is the thing you can do today and make it different instantaneously. The minute you say no straw at a bar or restaurant, you've kept one piece of plastic out of the environment like that. And that's as easy as that. I mean, not only are you informing your bartender or waitress, you're also educating people around you. And that's really what's making this grow, and it's really a community-oriented movement that's really taking on. It has far-reaching effects on our planet, and I think it's a great way to really help the plastic pollution movement. Because I call it the gateway issue, like the gateway drug. The minute people think about the straw, which they never think about, it opens their eyes to all the other single-use plastic in their lives. It really is. It really kind of sets that in motion, all the stuff we're doing, the single-use razor, the toothpick, you know, the floss, and things like that. They start to really think about it. It's kind of like that tangible thing, the first step, the thing that they can do. So basically, I'm just asking you to do less. Less consumption, less waste, less straws. That's a win-win. And if you, like I said, join us, you can save the world one sip at a time. And by just saying, simple act with no straws. One of the things I don't like to talk about taking something away from people without alternatives, and there are lots of alternatives. And I did ask my friends from Cords Mugs to come because one of the feedback I get a lot from people, and I'm not demonizing straws. I mean, 2 months into my campaign, my partner broke her jaw, and she needed straws. And there are people that need straws, people with sensitive teeth, there are people who like straws. It's no problem. But I really implore you, if you do like straws and enjoy straws, get your own, because you can get stainless steel, you can get a glass, and it's not, a lot of these straws have BPA in it, they're toxic. You don't want to be sipping out of a toxic tube, so they're all alternatives. And you do that, and these guys have a lot of samples up there, and one of the feedback I'm getting is I only use straws when I get this, stuff to go. And there's a lot of alternatives there. You'll see that you can do a mug to go for coffee, for your smoothie, and anything. There's a lot of alternatives. Hopefully, you guys had your last plastic straw moment today. Thank you. I end up just throwing them away. They don't get recycled. Yeah. I'm trying to gather them too to do an art project. So I want to, and that's part of my outreach too, because I want to get art involved in it. This gyre symposium I went to, it coincided with this exhibit that's going around called the Plastic Gyre. They had a lot of artists get actual plastic from the gyres, and they created this amazing art, and it's touring the country. So they had it at Georgia State University. And so they coincided this symposium with it. It was really great. And it's a great visual. I got contacted by Antigua Sailing Week. It's a huge regatta down in the Caribbean, out of the blue. And it's happening this week. It's a huge party. And they said, we, part of Clean Oceans, the Clean Boaters Program, and Sailors for the Sea, we want to do straws upon request for all of our participating restaurants. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, that's great. And they said, yeah, we're going to have a display. We're going to have art done with straws and have a visual. And I think that's great. So I would love to work with schools, with the tannery, with artists to do something with that, because that's some of the pushback I'm getting with some of the restaurants, too. Like, well, what am I going to do with this 2,000, you know, box of straws here? And I would love to just take it from them and do something and, you know, upcycle it, reuse it, and make it something that we can, you know. For them, the rationale is that it's in the environment already. It's been made. I have it. You know, I just don't want it. Do you have a question?
I have a question about your website. There's a lot of information on your website. Are there slides and stuff? Because I'm listening to you, I thought I should have brought my kids.
Kids are great. Yeah. And, you know, and I'm doing a lot. I'll talk to any school. I mean, because the kids are the ones, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, you feel bad when you talk to kids about plastic pollution. They get it. You know, the minute you see that poor turtle with the bag, and they mistake that for jellyfish, they just look at you with their eyes like, well, why are we doing it? And then you explain, well, you know, it's convenient. And then you feel like an idiot as an adult. You know, it's just like, and it's like that's been pushed on us in our society that we need this convenience of this single-use plastic. And it's their future, you know. And this is why I tell kids, and this is where I have hope, is that they really can redesign their future. Mm-hmm. And it's really, I'm doing the best I can to just kind of stop this tide. And, you know, because this, I never really thought about it, I travel all around, but you just can't get away from it. And it's just got to stop. And the plastics industry knows it. You know, they're just delaying as much as they can, because every day they delay, it's billions of more dollars in their pocket. And I just really feel that we've just been duped, that we need this. And we don't. There's alternatives. So, yeah, kids, I'm really reaching out to the Ocean Guardian schools. And all, like I said, if I'll come talk to any classroom.
What are some of your favorite documentaries? Like
Bagot. It's Wednesday. We're going to be showing a documentary at the Exploration Center in Santa Cruz, mm-hmm. if any of you guys are familiar. It's called Plastic Paradise. And I'm actually going to be, me and Rachel Kippen from Save Our Shores are going to be there. We're going to be part of the panel after for the Q&A. Okay. And that's another great one. But I have to say, as far as plastic pollution, I mean, not just because my friend made this film, when she saw I made a film, like, oh, great, it won awards. It's like, it is a great movie, and it's the first movie that I've seen that's just not a Debbie Downer, and it's a lot of information. As a kid who doesn't learn really well from books and more experiential, I wish I had a movie like that because I could see it and they really spell it out. It would make an easy report because they, you know, history, politics, plastic, plastic environment, and then health. And the health really blows you away, what's going on in there. And there's more movies coming out. I just got contacted by a documentary filmmaker and they wanted to do something on straws. So she said it would be a short documentary film. And if it all goes well, it's just in the development stage, that they'll be coming out by next year. So that was exciting.
That's great.
So yeah, so there's a lot of things coming out. But I would definitely, the go-to movie I'd say is Bag It. It's fun, it's entertaining, kids love it. They have curriculum around it too, so you can get it in schools, and I think they have it in Spanish now as well. Any questions? Yes?
Do you have suggestions for reminding yourselves that to ask for no straw? You're trying really hard to not use straws, and I forget to ask.
Yeah, it's, you know, even for me, it's hard. I mean, I usually, when I go out, it's like beer or wine, right? And then every once in a while, I'll treat myself to something like a margarita or a mojito, and I forget, and it's like, oh, I don't have a straw. And they still, sometimes it's just automatic, you see them do it. Yeah. It just bums me out, you know, I try. But just keep doing it, you know, you just gotta keep it. You gotta be proactive when you order it, you know, no straw, please. It does help, if you like straws, you have your own, and you show them, like, those droplets, I got my own, and that clicks, you know, that really helps. But still, it's just kind of retraining them, you know. It's a hard one, it really is. And my friends are the worst.
No.
I go out with them, and I'm like, hey, nobody knows straws, but then I have a little petrol case, and I have all these other alternatives to straws in there. I've got bamboo, I've got glass, I've got stainless steel, I've got paper, I've got them all. And I'm like, if you guys, anyone needs straw, just come see me, I'll give you a straw. And I have to get there early, and I gotta catch them. But I have to say, it's, you know, they've done studies on behavioral studies, and there's one that they've actually done a whole school around it now, B.J. Fogg, A Little Habits Lead to Big Habits. And it was actually around diabetes and heart disease. And now they're starting to reach out to environmental communities, and they're trying to get people into more immersing them, like going out to Año Nuevo and going to Fairlawn Islands, and they have to live a certain way out there, right? You can't bring your Starbucks cup out there. You can't bring all this stuff. So they're really introducing them to the direct impact of this single-use stuff. And they did a whole study with Woods Institute in Stanford, B.J. Fogg, and I think it was Oceanic Society doing this. Data's still out. But just wondering if they're gonna take those habits when they go home. Mm-hmm. But I did, in Santa Cruz of all places, I met a postdoctoral researcher for the Woods Institute that actually worked on that study on maternity leave. She was really, really prego at Midtown. And so she talked about it, and she goes, data's still out, but she goes, you know, they did a study with the, you know, when you go to hotels and they do the towels, and they said, you know, please refrain from, you know, getting your towel washed or your sheets because you'll save the environment. Well, they took one group and told them all the benefits to the environment that they'd do if they didn't get their towels and everything washed every day. The other group, they just told them 85% of people were doing it already. Guess which group complied the most? The one that was told 85% of people were doing it already. Mm-hmm. And it's really bizarre because, you know, starting this movement, like I said, I've been talking about it for the last 3 years, but lately, now that restaurants are starting to change over, they're like, oh yeah, I heard Oswald's has straws upon request on their own menu now. Mm-hmm. It's like, yeah, they do. So then other restaurants will start to take, because they don't want to be the first ones, but it's those trailblazers.
Yeah.
If you guys are ever in Moss Landing, go see the hot enchilada, not the whole enchilada, but the daughter, Hout enchilada. Kim Solano, she's like my poster child. She totally went whole hog, switched everything over to paper. She's making her staff not give them automatically, because that's the whole thing, too. That's a bigger picture, even if it's paper. Upon request, I mean, why are we wasting this stuff? And she's been great. It's just, so when they see the trailblazers do that, then the other restaurants start. And then since I started beginning press, it's very funny, my friends are all excited, they're so proud, And they're posting pictures of themselves on Facebook without a straw. And they're reporting to me which restaurants, you know, gave them a drink without a straw and things like that. It's very interesting, but it's kind of proving that point. Just kind of how we need that, you know, belonging or just feeling that we're not rocking the boat too much. But yeah. But yeah, it's an effort. You got to be proactive. The straw, please. It still might happen.
No straw, please.
But that's really what's making it.